I think this report is very essential, especially at the time when it is being released. That is the elections, where I think one sees the highest point of rhetoric that is spoken by everybody. I think for the last 5 years, somehow one feels like one is being ruled by the rhetoric, you know, and it has become the rule of the rhetoric. And so especially when it comes to issues concerning women, if there is a rape somewhere, then someone will stand up and say, now what we need to do is give a death penalty. You know, and the laws will be amended, and then, you know, like the POCSO was, and make laws stricter in the name of women, etc. And then try to then pass it off as, this is the concern that we have for women of the country. I think with the increase of women voters and women as a constituency, a lot of times you see the present government, etc., speaking for the woman allegedly. But it's very, very interesting when the rhetoric is so high, for us to somewhere step back and actually see what are these policies that the government is actually intending to pass. What are the bills? What will be the effect and implication if these bills or laws were to become laws and become effective? So therefore, what happens, a report like this, which also looks at certain bills that the government intended to pass in the name of women, also becomes very important. Even when it comes to women's rights and etc., it's not just a manipulation of parliamentary procedures when it comes to issues of Aadhaar, etc., where something is passed as a money bill. We also see the same thing happening in certain bills concerning women, especially the triple, which is commonly called the triple talaq bill, which the government tried to pass through the parliament, however was unable to do so. Therefore they bring it in the form of an ordinance. Ordinance is a power that is meant to be used by the president in situations which is emergent, expedient, whatever that is required, and something needs to be done till the parliament actually meets. It's not to be used just at the whim of the president or the whim of the government. And such use of powers of ordinance is also to a certain extent the abuse of the power of passing and promulgating an ordinance that the president does have. So we've seen that happening in the Muslim Women Protection of Rights and Marriage bill, which then for I think three times was passed as an ordinance. Now this bill also, I mean, at the face of it, what they say is that, okay, we're criminalizing the pronouncement of triple talaq, okay, which is the instantaneous triple talaq, or which is talaq-e-biddat. As we all know that in the Shaira Banu's case, the Supreme Court in 2017 said that pronouncing instantaneous triple talaq or talaq-e-biddat is illegal and it is void in law. Which means that if a Muslim husband pronounces talaq, 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 it in no way impacts the marriage or the rights of the woman. So therefore, the court actually said this is completely void. So it became literally utterances of words that had no consequence in law. So what the government does, taking this issue, they say that, okay, despite the order of the Supreme Court, there have been several pronouncements of talaq, because of which Muslim women have suffered. Therefore, we intend to pass this bill which criminalizes triple talaq, pronouncement of triple talaq. Now, if we say it criminalizes, so literally once the Supreme Court makes this void, then you're criminalizing an act that has no effect in law. And that is why I was saying that every time there is something, a bill that's being discussed, we need to step back and be able to see what actually is the effect of this and what could possibly be the intent of this. This has been made into a cognizable, non-bailable, available offence which are with up to three years of imprisonment. The punishment given is not proportionate if you see the other sections in the IPC, which are much graver offences. Further, also what is interesting to see is that in the name of women, and women being a very important constituency in an electoral politics, that how women and women's identity also, I mean the religious identity is also kind of attached to that, and then women become where the government uses those issues to kind of push even the communal agenda. So if triple talaq is not valid in law and has no consequence, ultimately the effect of a Muslim man pronouncing triple talaq literally amounts to deserting his wife, because otherwise he continues to be the husband. It has no consequences. So by criminalizing an act, what you're actually criminalizing is desertion of a wife. Are we saying that in no other community, no other men desert their wife? And does this desertion then become a criminal offense? So therefore, that is what I think somewhere is when we need to see when, I think like as Mihir was also saying, in these policies and bills. I mean, another example is of course the transgender person's bill that thankfully of course again did not get passed. Not only is there a hidden agenda in some of these bills, but also there is actually a lack of genuine concern and a lack of research that the government does before passing any of these bills. Again, the transgender person's bill comes as a result of an earlier judgment of the Supreme Court, which is the Nalsa judgment in 2014, where fundamental rights and identities of transgender persons were recognized. Now, even here, despite there being a long time movement by transgender persons, the law or the bill that is finally articulated by the government falls extremely short. It does not even address fundamental issue that was there in the Nalsa judgment, is self-determination of my gender. It is given to a screening committee and the people will have to go to the magistrate. So this is also another issue. So while one may see that, oh my God, India is progressing, we are even contemplating laws and legislations on transgender persons. Again, you need to step back and see what exactly is in this law that that the government intends to bring in. Again, of course, is the other bill of trafficking of persons, Prevention, Protection and Rehabilitation Bill of 2018. For a long time, there has been a demand from various activists that we need to have a comprehensive bill on trafficking and how do we deal with trafficking. Because as of now, what you have is you have the Indian Penal Code, Section 370 onwards, that criminalizes trafficking. You have the Bonded Labor Act, you have the Juvenile Justice Act, etc., which many of them that deal with trafficking itself. So therefore, again, there is a case that is going on in the court. Again, the Women and Child Department gives an assurance to the court that yes, we are in the process of formulating a law. And again, there is complete lack of application of mind or any research. And ultimately, what they end up bringing into this trafficking is, instead of bringing about a comprehensive law, they again end up just creating certain other authorities and agencies that that add to it, and a lot of contradictions and conflicting positions of the law on the issue of trafficking itself. And also, very interestingly, again stepping back looking at the law, you actually will see that the bill categorizes a person who encourages another to migrate illegally into India or for an Indian to migrate to another country as an aggravated form of trafficking. And many activists fear that on the part of the state, this is to criminalize migration in the guise of trafficking. So that, I mean, I think that's what this report does and intends to do, is that let's not just look at the title of the acts and, you know, whatever the government gives as a summary of the bill, but actually to look at each of the sections to say what it actually means and how when it is implemented. Now another and the last which I will finish with, which is very very interesting, is the surrogacy regulation bill. As we know, surrogacy was is permitted in the country, and even the medical the board had also kind of allowed it. But however, then there was this whole discussion, and they said that women and women's bodies are being misused and exploited, so therefore surrogacy must be regulated. So if you see, the bill says the surrogacy regulation bill of 2016. Okay, so we say that in the name of women, yes, let us, because this is complete exploitation of women. But like many activists ask, that the bill actually, when it says it is regulated, to a certain extent completely prohibits surrogacy. Okay, now further, it not only prohibits surrogacy, it says that women ought not to be surrogates, etc., but allows surrogacy within the family if you are related. So which means, while commercial surrogacy itself is banned, they allow surrogacy within the family and for relatives, etc. Which means altruistic surrogacy is permissible. Commercial surrogacy is not permissible. So you don't have a problem with surrogacy per se, but what you have a problem with is women being able to charge for it. And that is why the question arises, is that why then don't we look at it as sexual labor of women? So therefore, it's very important and interesting, especially when women and women's issues are constantly used for decades on end for political gains and political ends, that every time there is a bill, every time there is a policy, we step back, we look at it, and we look at it to say what finally is the effect of the law. And that, to a certain extent, is the purpose of this report, and I'm extremely grateful that it is being brought. Thank you.